in Trafalgar Square, and today we're going to talk about Jonathan Wild, the thief-taker general of England and of London. Now, this square wouldn't have been around in his time, but it does illustrate a nice point when we begin on our journey, talking about one of the men who started off real law enforcement here in the country. Although he was also behind a lot of the crime that that law enforcement was there to curb. He's a very interesting figure. Many of his interrogation tactics are still used by the police today, and many of his criminal schemes are used by criminals as well. So he's really behind a lot of the law and crime in this country for the rest of the world. Now, when he first arrived to London, he was a country boy from Wolverhampton. And although this square was not here in his time, he first arrived in London in 1704, it does illustrate a nice point and give you the same notion that he might have had. When he came to London, he was wowed. I mean, look at all this. Look at all these people here. You know, that would have been his reaction. He first came here as a servant to another master, served him for a couple of years before he was dismissed. He probably didn't do so good a job as a servant. He came back to London in 1708. It didn't take very long for him to get in trouble, though. Clearly, he couldn't sustain himself because he ended up in a debtor's jail just 2 years later in 1710. So, where he was thrown into jail for being massively in debt, but that is where his legend would begin to rise, because it was in jail or prison that he would learn his trade as a thief taker. And it was not for nothing that it was known and is still known today as a school for criminals being in prison. And gradually, he would take any job that the jailers gave him. It didn't matter how degrading it was or how unpopular he got with his fellow cellmates, he was willing to do anything to get on the good side of the jailers. And that actually increased him in the ranks of prison and gradually gave him more and more liberties. He also became rather astute with the law and was able to read and write himself and could often give legal advice to other prisoners in the Wood Street Compter, that was the name of the prison he went to. So he would have mock trials with the other prisoners. And quite often what they would do is they would dress themselves up, pretend to be a judge, maybe use a towel to represent the wig that the judge would have. And they'd go through these mock trials, preparing them for their own legal trial where the prisoners would usually have to defend themselves. And it was in this environment that he first caught the attention, about 4 years later in 1712, of Hitchens. Hitchens, who was the current thief-taker general in the city, the one who was in charge of curbing crime, took a liking, took a little shining to our main character, to Jonathan Wild, and allowed him to start working for him as an assistant. What that meant was that he would have to be his extended arm, and he would have to track down criminals who hadn't fenced their goods in yet. He would have to try and locate the owners of stolen property to find out whose stolen wares belonged to whom. Shake down people that hadn't paid their due diligence, schmoozing up magistrates, and so on and so on. That job required a real knack for remembering faces and names and sort of a menacing charm, which was what Jonathan excelled at. He was very good at intimidating people. He was also quite good at persuading people, which we would soon discover when he took over Hitchens' job.
When Jonathan Wild started working for Hitchens in 1712, one of the places that he would have undoubtedly gone to would be here in St. Giles. Now, his job included such things as tracking down thieves not stealing enough for Hitchens, or selling to competing fences. He might be buying drinks and schmoozing magistrates in taverns, or finding out who owned the stolen goods so they could sell it back to them. All this sort of underwork was what he did when he was dubbed Under Marshal by Hitchens. The original layout of St. Giles was laid down by Thomas Neale in the 1690s. The area was intended to attract the upper crust of society, forming the streets in a unique fan of six roads converging into a single plaza, later increased to seven, with a sundial in the middle. The plan was to have triangular fronts, as that would cost less than rent, since rentage was charged per foot in frontage rather than the whole per square feet of the building. Unfortunately for Neale, it ended up turning into one of London's most notorious slums, and so it would certainly have been a main area of enterprise for the under-marshal Jonathan Wild and his master Hitchens. Later in the 19th century, the infamy of the area was well known. Here are a few quotes to illustrate that, such as by Charles Dickens when he wrote, "Streets and courts that dart in all directions until they're lost in the unwholesome vapour which hangs over the housetops and renders the dirty perspective uncertain and confined." And the poet John Keats described the area as the last resort for the poor and the ill, where misery clings to misery for a little warmth, and want and disease lie down side by side and groan together. By 1714, Jonathan had outgrown his partnership with Hitchens, but he still used his fake title as his deputy to his advantage. He got his own office in the Blue Boar Tavern in the Little Old Bailey, where well-to-do clients could come and seek him out for lost items.
So, Jonathan really started a thief-taking business under Hitchens. Hitchens was showing him the way, he was giving him a lot of his contacts, and he granted him the title of being an under-marshal, which meant that he represented Hitchens' authority. Now, it didn't take very long before Jonathan outgrew their relationship and thought he could do the job much better than Hitchens himself. After only about 2 years, he had distanced himself from the partnership of Hitchens, but he still used his title as under-marshal or deputy. Falsely, of course, but he pretended to still have this title when he was throwing his weight around and bossing around thieves in the area. Now, as an example of some of the thievery that was taking place, just to give you an idea of how specialized thievery and how much crime was a craft in London in the 1700s, I'll give you a few examples of what some thieves might have been doing in an environment like this here. So if you imagine we are 300 years back in the past, a lot of these people here would have been minor nobility or certainly up in the upper echelons. And that meant a lot of them would wear wigs. Now some thieves, they specialized in stealing wigs because that was very valuable. You actually call them wool pullers, where that expression comes from, pulling the wool over someone, right? They would pull wool from others' heads. Sometimes they would even use fishing hooks to get off wigs from people's heads. So if you look down here, you can see that down there, there would have been a lot of wigs on top of people's heads. An angler, as they called him, might have stood here with a fishing rod and tried to fish off some of those wigs, or maybe some pocket watches or some purses from waistcoats, and they could safely get them up here and quickly run away. There were certain ranks and orders to the thieves, which was something Jonathan would have to learn fairly quickly. What about the food chain of criminals? You had pie shammers, who were people who stole food. That was considered the lowest rank. Just above them you had pickpockets. Of course the pickpockets, they saw themselves as much more professional than putting shammers. And then above pickpockets, you might have housebreakers, or milkins, as you call them, who specialized in breaking into people's homes when they were not around, when they might have been out and about enjoying a market like this here instead. And of course, above the housebreakers, you'd have highwaymen, the gentlemen thieves, they would be top of the order, spruce pigs, which was something that Jonathan specialized later on, were thieves that pretended to be nobility and could mix in with nobles at parties and masquerades and then rob them blind when their guard was down. And that was actually something he specialized training his thieves in. So soon enough, Jonathan would establish his own corporation of thieves. And that is where he started to rival the power of Hitchens and eventually outgrow his power.
Wilde would soon be acquainted with the many specialties that were surrounding various criminals in London. He would also get an intimate understanding of the strange but surprisingly complex hierarchy amongst thieves and criminals. Here are a few examples of the various specialties of crime that existed. A hook pole lay was an ambusher with a long pole and a hook at the end, who specialised in unseating riders from horses and robbing them. An angler would fish from carriages or windows, the wigs and hats of people below them, or wallets from their waistcoat pockets with a fishing hook and line. Wig thieves were known as wool pullers. Milken were known as housebreakers. Sometimes they would knock on the door and force their way inside as well, or make contact with resentful servants to get in, or become lovers of maids that could allow them to slip inside. A stroller would claim to be the servant of a rich gentleman, deceiving money or goods out of shops or taverns. An Adam Tyler distracted a victim while another pickpocketed them. And he was specializing particularly in training spruce pigs later on, when he formed his corporation of thieves. Spruce pigs were thieves trained to blend in at banquets and fancy operas, so they were meant to be able to mingle with the nobility and upper crust there. Jonathan taught his thieves how to dance to be able to blend in at fancy parties. Usually, spruce pigs were drawn from ex-footmen who had served in noble houses beforehand. These criminals would have mixed in with another motley lot around St. Giles. Prostitutes plying their trade, desperate gamblers trying to save their family's fortunes, highwaymen lost their profits on drinks, and drunks stumbling out from one coffee house to the next. According to the journalist Ned Ward, even the flower girls stank so much of brandy and tobacco that it overcame the fragrance of their flowers. This was St. Giles in the 1700s.
Well, we are near where Lincoln's Inn Fields... Lincoln's Inn Fields Theatre used to be. And this theatre got famous for putting on the Thieves' Opera, which is one of the main literature references we've got to Jonathan Wilde today. So the character of Mr. Peacham is directly inspired by Jonathan Wilde. And what does Peacham do? Well, he's got a whole corporation of thieves and prostitutes below him that he uses and discards as soon as he has no more use for them, and collects his reward after sending them off to be hanged or for transportation to America. That is exactly what Jonathan Wilde did as well. So this play was really what put Jonathan Wilde and Jack Sheppard, which we have covered in another video, on the map, and the literary map, let's say. The theatre was opened by John Ridge, and the play was written by John Gay. Now, there's a saying about the Thieves' Opera. They say that it made Gay rich, and it made Rich gay, is one popular saying about the Thieves' Opera, at least. So it's one of the more famous bits of literature that we've got surviving. That gives us a nice illustration of Jonathan Wilde and what his character might have been like. So, as our fine lady of commerce here nicely illustrates, Jonathan soon discovered that the business of thief-taking was something he could make bank on. But he had a few ideas to improve upon the system that Hitchens had left behind for him. So he started his own corporation of thieves, and he set up his office not too far from here, down at what's known as the Old Bailey these days. He put himself in a little attic office in what was called the Blue Boar Tavern. And that is where he could start organizing his crime from, and he could make a double turn of inviting clients to come in to his office to find stolen goods. And very soon he established himself as the prominent thief taker of London, and someone who you could reliably go to. If you had anything stolen, you could go and find Jonathan Wilde and reliably recover your stolen goods from him, usually because if you had lost something, it tended to be in his drawer. Now, it was a handy way of him keeping track of his thieves as well, because through these clients, he could corroborate the story with them and figure out what his criminals that were working for him were up to. And as an example of how much money he made, there was one instance in 1714 where a group of Milkins, a group of housebreakers, managed to break into the Royal Banqueting Hall back in Whitehall. And they stole lots of goods there. He managed to keep tabs on them, and he quickly learned where they were because they were working for him, and where they hid, and where they had all those stolen goods. Now, there were seven thieves. He managed to get them all hung and tried. Back then, you would make £40 on delivering a thief like this to the government. So 40 times seven, we're certainly getting up there in terms of money. He made, from a total amount, he made about £700 from that whole affair. Of first having all the stolen goods fenced, and then selling out the thieves that had worked for him before. Just for reference, an average laborer in London would perhaps make £30 a year. This was the commerce of crime, and Jonathan was on top of it. This is the area where he had his operations, which was a perfect location for Jonathan Wild, because he had Newgate Prison right over there, along with the Old Bailey, where all the criminals were being tried and convicted. So he could have his little office in the Blue Boar Tavern, which would have been somewhere around here, and have clients walk straight into him, who would be inquiring about their various stolen goods. Now, he started to become so organized, and something he mastered way beyond Hitchens, that he had a ledger where he wrote down every single name of various criminals that worked under him or that worked in London. And as soon as he had enough evidence to try one of those criminals, he would mark their name with one cross. Now, interestingly, this is where the term double cross comes from, because when he then had one of those criminals charged and either got them hung or transported to America, he would mark their name with a little extra cross, with a double cross. So he became very organized about the whole affair. And the event that really put his name out in the streets and made him famous was in 1717, when a very controversial murder had happened of an elderly grandmother called Mrs. Knapp, who was accompanying her son around Jockey Fields near Gray's Inn. The son was knocked out by a couple of highwaymen who stole his goods, and one of the highwaymen discharged his pistol and killed the grandmother. Now, this spread outrage throughout all of London, and Wild, being the savvy PR man that he was, capitalized on that. And he made a public statement where he said, "I never pardon murder." And he decided to hunt down these thieves, who he knew who were, or at least he knew one of them, Isaac Ragg. So Isaac had already one X marked out from his name, so he could locate Isaac, and he could use that interrogation tactic that police would use later on, also in our day, by claiming that he had other thieves caught that would impeach him. And he could use the previous evidence he had collected on Isaac to have him hung. So he threatened Isaac to tell him where the other thieves were. And eventually he buckled under that interrogation, which allowed Jonathan Wild to collect a posse, track down the thieves, and bring them to justice. This was what made him famous in the streets, and it only caused a boom in his business, and many more clients started coming to Jonathan Wild. It also meant that many other criminals knew not to mess with him, because they could see how much power he had over them and how easy it was for him to track them down. So after this event, all the criminals in the underbelly of London knew not to mess with Jonathan Wild. So
So, with his growing fame, of course, there were people that were trying to undermine his reputation. One of those people happened to be his former master, Hitchens, who wrote anonymously as a writer that the thief taker is a thief maker. Because he clearly knew how Jonathan Wild was operating his business. He knew that all the criminals that worked for him, he could discard them as quickly as he got them to work for him. And quite often he would encourage criminals to get into crime so he could use them and then later sell them to the authorities. Now, since this was a direct attack on his reputation, he thought his best defense was an offense. And he decided to undermine the reputation of Hitchens himself. First of all, by revealing who the anonymous writer was and getting into the fact that Hitchens himself was a corrupt official. But the most damning thing he had to say against him was accusing him of sodomy. Hitchens apparently had a bit of a thing with dressing himself up as a woman occasionally, or at least that's what Jonathan claimed. But he managed to circulate the rumors well enough to undermine the authority of Hitchens. And it got so bad for his former master that he was actually subjected to the pillory here in the City of London. Now, Hitchens knew that he was not the most popular guy amongst people. Plenty of criminals and working class people had been extorted by him in the past. So he prepared himself for a trip in the pillory by dressing himself in armor. But even that couldn't save him. He was so badly beaten up by the public that he actually died from his injuries later on. And for Jonathan, it meant he had gotten rid of another member of the competition and another rival. And nothing seemed able to stop Wild at this point. I will just share one quote here from Wild that was a great response to Hitchens and to his claims. And it's very ironic because the response here, he clearly knew that he was doing all these illegal things, and yet he was able to keep this virtuous exterior. And I'll just give you the notion here. What he responded to Hitchens, calling him a thief maker rather than a thief taker. He said, "To say that justice is governed by a thief taker is such a slur to the governance of the magistrate and such an affront to authority that nothing can equal it." Which is ironic because he knew that was exactly what was going down. So in a way, Wild was probably for himself criticizing the justice system in this country and in London that he knew was just as corrupt as himself. Now, we'll be about to head into the Viaduct Tavern here, because right below this tavern, it's built on top of some of the remains of Newgate Prison. Newgate Prison was, of course, one of the main areas of business for Jonathan, but it would also prove to be his end and where he would get a taste of his own medicine at the end of his life. When he was in his early 40s, he ended his criminal career. In the end, after having his throat slit by Blueskin Blake, which we covered in our other video about Jack Shepherd, Jonathan got a taste of his own medicine finally. Many of the thieves that had formerly worked for him started turning on him and sullying the reputation he had carefully manufactured for himself. And since he was still recovering from his injuries, he couldn't do much in the way of retribution. Soon, the courts and magistrates were convinced that the thief taker was indeed a thief maker and decided to imprison him here in Newgate Prison. First, he kept a brave face, continuing his business as usual from his prison cell and seeing clients there still. He was confident that the skills he had used in court before to sentence or liberate criminals in the past could be used to save himself. Or, at least, he pretended to be confident. But as testimony after testimony started plying in from his fellow cronies, Wilde's prospects dimmed and his hopes fell with a final conviction on the 15th of May, 1725. While he would be executed in Tyburn, really, the end for Wilde was here in Newgate Prison, perhaps in this very cell, where he would have faced the prospect of hanging in front of many of his peers and the people he had subjugated for years. Unlike a popular figure like Jack Shepherd, Jonathan Wild was certain to face the wrath of the mob. He
even attempted to take his own life in prison to avoid that sorry fate of death and humiliation by drinking a large dose of laudanum, but that only caused him to vomit and sink into a deep coma. When he was finally taken to the gallows at Tyburn on the 24th of May 1725, Defoe said that the crowd was far larger than any they had seen before, and that instead of any celebration or commiseration with the condemned, wherever he came, there was nothing but hollowing and hussars, as if it had been upon a triumph. And that's how the life of the great thief-taker ended. Like a man who lives by the sword and dies by the sword, Jonathan indeed lived by his guiles and wit and cunning, and he died for the same thing. The very fate he had subjected so many other people before him to, he ended up tasting himself. And, compared to many of the others he had condemned, he did not go off in a dignified manner, but feared death all the way to the bitter end.